This video is sponsored by Gainful. Apple and Samsung are two of the biggest tech giants out there. Each of them has their own respectable ecosystems. Apple initially was a software first, hardware second based company, but now it seems like they're nearly half and half. Samsung, on the other hand, is a more hardware based company with software being second, since they rely heavily on other platforms. For example, One UI couldn't exist in its current stage without Google's Android OS, and Samsung laptops all currently ship with Microsoft Windows, two platforms that Samsung works closely with but does not control. On the other hand, Samsung does have their own OS called Tizen that ships on watches and appliances like their smart fridges and TVs. In this video, I want to compare these two ecosystems. This way, if you're looking to invest in one over the other, hopefully this will help you with your decision. I'm not going to be extremely detailed with this comparison since that would take hours, but I will cover the important aspects in a more generalized format. First, let's talk about devices. This is an area I feel Samsung really shines since they have so many different product categories. They offer traditional household appliances like washers, dryers, refrigerators, stoves, microwaves, dishwashers, vacuums, and mops. They also have TVs, speakers, computers, monitors, smartphones, tablets, headphones, watches, and so much more. Samsung has a massive footprint in nearly every single consumer tech category, and they have levels to each category as well based on budget and need. It's absolutely crazy to think about. Apple, on the other hand, doesn't have nearly as many products, but this has worked extremely well for them. They offer some of the best customer support in the industry since their workers don't need to be educated on nearly as many items. Apple offers more consumer-focused tech rather than home appliances. For example, they offer smartphones, watches, tablets, computers, headphones, speakers, and of course, accessories and peripherals to go along with all of these things. There really isn't a right or wrong way to build out your ecosystem when it comes to product catalog, as can be seen here with two entirely different approaches. One keeps their catalog tidy and controlled, while the other is set on global domination. Honestly, it doesn't matter what you produce in terms of devices or the amount of, it comes down to how you interact with them and how well they interact with each other, at least from an ecosystem perspective. This brings me to my next point, which is the bond between software and hardware. For example, I heavily rely on my Apple Watch day in and day out since fitness and health has become a major part of my life. My Apple Watch pairs seamlessly with my iPhone and in return is able to send and receive data back and forth. This allows me to view my health and fitness stats on my iPhone at any time. I can link third-party apps downloaded on my phone to my watch given that there is support to create complications to quickly dive into certain tasks. This is helpful when I want to start a workout and track it via the BOD app, or if I'm logging a meal via MyFitnessPal. Samsung offers similar functionality, but before we get into that, let me tell you a little bit more about this video's sponsor, Gainful, which has been my go-to for sports nutrition these past few months. So let me tell you a little bit more about Gainful because my package just came in. Gainful is a sports nutrition subscription service all about empowering you to reach your fitness and nutrition goals with personalized protein powder, hydration, and pre-workout tailored to your body type, fitness routine, and dietary supplements. Best of all, you don't even have to think about it. It comes delivered right to your door in a nice, neat package. Gainful is for everybody, with personalized protein customized to your fitness goals and dietary restrictions. You take a quiz to determine your custom blend, and you can change it up at any time. This is one thing that I absolutely love about Gainful, and the quiz only takes a matter of minutes. Whether you're a professional athlete or a fitness enthusiast like I am, Gainful's personalized nutrition can support your fitness goals. When I went through the personalization process, Gainful determined that I needed pre-workout because I'll be working out in the evenings and it gives me a little boost before my workouts, hydration packets in order to promote recovery and enhance hydration, and then of course plenty of protein to promote muscle growth. I also have my flavor packets. The ones that I chose are cafe mocha, strawberries and cream, cookies and cream, and variety packets that have all of their most popular flavors. So here's an example of my profile, which I created during the personalization process. And you can see I inputted all of my goals and what I want to achieve and what I'll be using Gainful for in order to come up with an individualized plan, which is awesome. The quality behind Gainful's products is simple. They use effective formulas with clean ingredients that I can pronounce, which is definitely a plus. They're non-GMO, there's no fillers or artificial ingredients. They're developed with Gainful Science Advisory Board of sports nutrition experts from pro and Olympic level teams. Another major plus if you choose to go with Gainful is that you get one-on-one access with a registered dietitian, and this sometimes could cost you well over $100, and they're just including it with your subscription. That's definitely a win. Last year, I decided to be more health conscious, and I've really been taking my fitness journey extremely serious, not just for myself, but for my future kids. I want to be in the best health and best shape possible in order to keep up with them. So if you guys want to learn more about Gainful, make sure to click the link down in the description. It'll take you over to the website. You can save yourself some money if you use my link, and also you're supporting a good company with clean products. Samsung has a slightly different approach to health and fitness. When it comes to device connectivity, it's very similar. So as your watch tracks your stats, it will instantly sync back to your phone, just like the Apple Watch and iPhone. Depending on the Samsung and the Apple Watch we're talking about, both have their own strengths. I haven't done a watch comparison in forever, so let me know if this is something that you would like to see. For this video, I strictly want to focus more on continuity and connectivity rather than device versus device. Just like the Apple Watch, Samsung allows you to add apps to their watches via your smartphone. Although the apps are not as robust, the catalog is not as vast, and in my opinion, overall, things just don't seem to be as intuitive, I would say. Apple somewhat recently started a subscription service for Fitness Plus, which ties in the Apple Watch very well. It displays your watch info like calories burned, heart rate, and workout time on your screen if you're using an iPad or an Apple TV. This eliminates the need to look at your watch while you're working out, and I think that's pretty useful. Samsung offers their own respectable health service titled Samsung Health. If you pick a workout from this service, it will display your heart rate info on the screen as you work out in a similar format to Apple's approach, but I would say a more slimmed down version. We'll come back to Apple Fitness Plus and Samsung Health once we get to services. For now, let's look at how well other devices work together. Apple's Mac computers and iPads work very well together thanks to Sidecar, which ultimately allows the iPad to become an external display or drawing tablet for the Mac. The process is mostly seamless, though I have noticed issues with connectivity from time to time. The same thing can be said about AirPods and automatic switching from, let's say, iPhone, Mac, and iPad. For the most part, it works fantastic, but there are certainly hiccups from time to time. Samsung offers a similar experience with their tablets, given that you have a Tab S7 series or later in a Galaxy laptop like the Galaxy Book 360 Pro. Setting it up, in my opinion, is just as easy given that you have experience with Android and Windows, and the experience is nearly identical. To be honest, I've had less connection issues with Samsung's implementation, but the actual experience has been better with Apple. Galaxy Buds also offer automatic connection from device to device, and if they're near each other, the notification pops up nearly every time, just like with Apple. Another great example of continuity and device connectivity is with AirDrop on Apple. This is one feature that I myself love and many others can't live without. Wireless sharing videos, photos, and files to and from different Apple devices is fantastic. But once again, Samsung has their own implementation, and this is known as Quick Share. It works in a similar way to AirDrop, although it's not as intuitive and it does require more steps at times. However, once you figure it out, it can be every bit as fast. I do understand there are plenty of free third-party options out there with similar functionality that are cross-platform, but for the sake of this video, I wanted to compare software directly from each respectable company. Of course, I can't talk about connectivity without mentioning iMessage. Some people will argue and say it's overrated, and apps like WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, or Telegram are much better alternatives, and I can't fault you for saying that. However, in the US, which is where I live, people rely on iMessage more so than any other messaging service, to my knowledge. My circle of friends and family will not download a third-party messaging app just so I can see photos at higher resolution or receive full-res video files. It's just not going to happen. This is why it's difficult for me to leave Apple completely, although I do have my own workarounds and they've been working out pretty well. Samsung does have an upcoming app for Windows called Samsung Messages, which will be an iMessage competitor. Currently, if you're sending photos or videos from Samsung to Samsung mobile devices, you can receive high resolution photos and videos just like iMessage, but the issue is keeping things in sync with other devices like Galaxy tablets and PCs. There are numerous workarounds. As I said, third-party apps are out there, but this is one area that I feel Apple has the game on lock. Samsung does have a few tricks up their sleeves. The first being Windows Companion app, which allows you to text from your computer and even control your phone in many ways. The implementation is sloppy, but the functionality is pretty good once you figure it out, pending there are no issues with connectivity. The second feature Samsung has is Dex, which is very powerful given that it opens up potential to other devices like Galaxy tablets and smartphones when paired with other Samsung products like monitors and TVs. In a nutshell, it turns your phone or tablet into a Chromebook, and you can connect it using a cable or wirelessly, which is really nice. Where Samsung really shines on the connectivity and continuity front is with their home appliances and the SmartThings platform. Having your washer and dryer send you notifications when they're finished, or being able to peep into your fridge to see what you need from the grocery store when you're at the grocery store is pretty awesome. Nearly all of Samsung's modern home appliances and devices run off the SmartThings platform and can be easily intertwined with your phone, tablet, or Samsung computer. I mean, you can even control your SmartThings devices from your Samsung TV. It's pretty neat to be watching the news in the morning and you get an alert from your Samsung AirDresser that your work uniform is cleaned, steamed, and ready to go. Apple utilizes HomeKit, which is mostly available for third-party manufacturers to use, but they do offer a couple OEM products like the HomePod and Apple TV that take advantage of HomeKit. You know how I said Apple is a 50-50 company now since they make their own software and have invested a lot into their own hardware? Well, that's how Samsung is with their smart home devices and appliances in a way. Although SmartThings still supports tons of third-party products as well. Again, there's a lot more to it when it comes to smart home, and I'm no pro. This is only looking at things from a manufacturer to manufacturer perspective. SmartThings also works with the new Samsung Smart Trackers, which allows you to track your things like keys, wallets, dogs, or even a loved one. Apple's tracker works nearly the same, except is run off the Find My network. Again, same thing, just two different approaches. Finally, let's talk services. Apple has many paid subscription services. This includes Fitness Plus, Apple Music, Apple TV Plus, Apple Arcade, iCloud, and Apple News Plus. These services can be purchased individually, but it's probably best just to grab a bundle. There are three bundles available, an individual plan for $14.95, which includes Music, TV Plus, Arcade, and 50 gigabytes of iCloud storage. The family plan, which is $19.95, includes the same thing as the individual plan, but comes with 200 gigabytes of iCloud storage. This plan can also be shared with up to 5 other people. Lastly, the Premier plan is $29.95. It comes with everything the other two plans come with and has 2 terabytes of iCloud storage. You get News Plus and Fitness Plus. This plan can be shared with up to 5 people as well. It should also be known that Apple offers regular news and 5 gigabytes of iCloud storage for free. Samsung, on the other hand, is a bit different. Samsung has a plethora of services, but they're free. This includes Samsung Free on mobile devices, which comes with live TV, news and articles, podcasts, and several games. You also get free cloud storage, but there's a catch. Samsung recently decided to shut down its own cloud storage and partner with Microsoft to use OneDrive. If you've had a previous Samsung account, you were given 15 gigabytes of Samsung cloud storage, which will migrate directly to OneDrive. If, however, you are new to Samsung, you will only be given 5 gigabytes of OneDrive storage. You also get secure Wi-Fi on certain smartphones and tablets, which is powered by McAfee. It basically runs internet traffic through a filter to ensure things are safe. Additionally, Samsung offers several free workouts within Samsung Health that you can do at any time. This includes things like yoga, HIIT, core, and many other workouts. Samsung has partners with many other professional fitness services and allows you to link those services directly to Samsung Health to expand their catalog of workouts. For example, Calm can be purchased for $5 a month with an annual plan, and it offers a variety of audio-based programs to reduce anxiety, depression, stress, and insomnia. Anyone that owns a Samsung product can take advantage of Samsung Health. It's not just limited to their mobile-only products. The majority of Samsung's most recent TVs ship with Samsung Health pre-installed. Speaking of TV, Samsung also has plenty of free entertainment preloaded on their TVs. This includes live TV and an entire library of movies that is constantly being updated. Neither of these require a subscription, which is wonderful. Samsung makes up the cost for these services by displaying ads on their platforms. I've seen quite a few complaints from people regarding Samsung's One UI displaying ads or even ads being shown on Samsung's TV interface, but not one person realizes how much free stuff Samsung is giving you. This is far different than Apple since they require you to purchase subscriptions to enjoy a lot of these same features and content, which means they can keep the experience clean overall while also delivering slightly higher quality services with newer additions. TV-wise, Apple requires you to purchase an Apple TV which can be linked to any television via HDMI. From there, you have access to Apple TV Plus, iTunes, and a huge library of apps, games, and other streaming services. This is one area that I feel Apple wins overall. Apple just has better third-party app support regardless of platform. iOS, iPadOS, macOS, watchOS, and tvOS have much larger libraries than Android and Tizen, at least when it comes to fully updated and optimized apps. Although, most of the more popular apps such as Netflix, HBO, social media apps, and more are available on both platforms. Let me try to wrap this up the best that I can because this video was long and kind of all over the place. Samsung and Apple have built incredible ecosystems, and now is one of the best times ever to pick one to join. If you're wanting a clean, user-friendly experience, personally, I would go with Apple. This is especially the case if you're only concerned with the bare minimal for your ecosystem. Think phone, tablet, computer, and wearable. If you want to create an entire ecosystem and stick to one household name, choose Samsung. They offer more products, and these products will talk and work wonderfully with each other. Apple will require you to use more third-party products and apps to achieve what Samsung offers by sticking to a single name. Ultimately, you can't go wrong with either, and it's totally fine to mix and match. If there are any parts of this video you would like to see broken down even further, please let me know and I'll do what I can to deliver that video. If you want to see a comparison between Siri and Bixby, also let me know since that's a video entirely on its own. I hope this video was helpful to you. If it was, please consider giving it a thumbs up. Subscribe for more videos like this and I'll see you amazing people in the next one.